Okay, Aris, let's begin with details on how you would actually describe President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s 2025 midterm elections senatorial slate.
I think it's quite clear that the Marcos Jr. administration wants to retain control of the upper chamber of our Congress. And the slate is a mixture of returning senators, re-electionists, but also science of political dynasties. In fact, with the exception of Secretary Benhur Abalos, most of the, the 11 of the 12 senatorial candidates of the administrative coalition either have been re-electionists or have been senators before or are relatives of previous senators. So it's quite clear that this is a dynastic senatorial slate and one that reinforces the idea that in Philippine politics nowadays, dynasties is the way to go.
Right. Speaking of dynasties, I'm quite interested to know if the name recall, as well as the political branding, is obviously strong in the president's slate. But do you see that voters are already experiencing a fatigue when it comes to old names as well as traditional politicians?
We have yet to see that. And from someone who's been studying Philippine democracy for a while, I would think that voters would have this fatigue or this parang ayaw na ng dynasties kasi parating sila na lang, no? And the idea of quote-unquote iba naman and newer voices, although one candidate in the slate is claiming that this candidate offers a new voice except being part of an entrenched dynasty. One could claim that in democracy, representation needs to be always diverse. It needs to always be refreshed with other actors because if not, then it's like water. No, the institution will stagnate if it's the same water or the same source of leadership is coming from the same set of political families.
Okay, Aris, let's talk about regional politics here. Most of the candidates in the president's slates are basically from Luzon. You only have Manny Pacquiao representing Mindanao and the Visayas. I'm not sure if you have anyone on the slate who is from Visayas or at least lived in the Visayas for a significant number of years. Tell us about the dynamics here when it comes to representation, because we know that they will go around the country to campaign and most of their candidates are based in Luzon.
Yes, that's correct, Katrina. Difference between our senators, unlike the senators in the United States, is that they're nationally elected and therefore they need to campaign nationally. And this is why there's also this informal rule that once you've been elected as a senator, then the presidency is just a step away, given the same constituency elects you as senator and as president. Regional support is quite critical because I think it will really be a highly competitive senatorial elections because you really have so many names that have name recall, that are popular, that are re-elected, that are dynastic, re-electionist, I mean. And therefore, every source of support counts. And you're correct, there's a glaring absence of representation from a third of the country's population, which is in Mindanao. And I do think that the
we have back with us UP Department of Political Science Chairperson Aris Arugay. Welcome back, Aris.
Thanks for having me again, Katrina. Apologies for the technical difficulties.
No worries there. A while ago, we were talking about on whether or not it was a wise decision for the president and his alliance to actually include or populate his slate with politicians who are mainly from Luzon. You were saying a while ago before you got cut off?
Yes, the idea of being able to win a Senate seat is that you'll be able to get as much support as you may want, and it's quite a highly competitive, I would imagine, senatorial elections next year, given there's so many candidates, there's so many names, and it could really be a challenge in to make it to the top 12. So therefore, if you have one third of the country that is not underrepresented in the slate, that may affect the ability of some of the senatorial candidates within the administration slate to get some votes. And this is, I think, where I predict that some of the administration slate's candidates will have to solicit support to powerful power brokers in Mindanao and perhaps even the Duterte. So we might even see what we call candidates that would be supported not only by the administration, but by powerful dynasties in Mindanao as well, that includes the Dutertes.
Right. I just have to point out here, Aris, the interesting lineup that they did here, because they have three people from Cavite alone, one of the most vote-rich provinces in the city, in the Philippines rather. You have Ping Lacson, you have Tolentino, as well as Revilla, all hailing from Cavite. Metro Manila, also well represented. Binay from Makati, Cayetano from Taguig, and you also have Villar from Las Piñas, if I'm not mistaken, while Soto has roots from Cebu, and while Amy Marcos also has roots from Tacloban, they are basically more known as people either from Metro Manila, because Soto served as Quezon City Vice Mayor, while Amy Marcos is more is a more popular figure in Ilocos, where she served as governor before. But despite this lack of variety when it comes to the regions where they hail from, they are all part of major political parties here. You have a coalition from the NPC, from the Nacionalista, from the Lakas CMD, all parties with very big machineries. Do you think that that will be able to offset the lack of variance when it comes to their regional roots?
Yes, definitely the national local linkage between senatorial candidates and their local support. And this is why I think it's critical if these senatorial candidates already have relatives or allies that are rooted in local politics, because in Philippine elections, these local political elites are able to deliver on behalf of national level politicians. So this will be clearly tested. And you're correct, some parts of Manila and the nearby regions in Luzon seem to be overrepresented with a number of candidates hailing from these provinces. And this is why extra sources of support, one that goes beyond their respective bailiwicks and the respective strongholds of their dynasties, I think will be critical in this coming elections.
Aris, what do you make out of the absence of Senator Amy Marcos at the Alianza's launching event, despite her actual inclusion in her brother's slate?
Well, I mean, we would expect that Senator, former Senator Amy Marcos will participate, because it's quite important for her to show that she's very supportive of the administration, and the glaring absence might not mean so much into it. But let us remember that former Senator Marcos is also quite close to the Dutertes, as confessed by Vice President Sara Duterte herself. So perhaps Marcos might be one of those candidates that would be able to bridge and get some level of support from both major power factions in Philippine politics at the moment. Okay. And I think this is an added advantage for her compared to the other candidates that might be solely relying on President Marcos and the administration.
Okay, we will have to wait and see on how the senator would actually perform during the campaign period. But let's talk about the other side of the political spectrum. You have the president endorsing big political names with deep war chests. What now can other senatorial aspirants do to increase their chances against the Alianza's political machinery?
Yes, definitely. That's their greatest asset. Not only are these seasoned and dynastic politicians, they do have the level of support that will be given by the administration, and that's always an advantage. It's almost like an incumbency advantage, but not entirely. But also, let's remember, Katrina, that the 2025 senatorial elections is also informally a referendum on the president and his administration. So the key here, as we have heard, is that as many candidates from the administration slate as possible is to be in the Senate is the goal, because this reinforces that the leadership of the current administration is legitimate and is popular and is well accepted. So we're gonna see really no stone will be unturned in terms of being able to ensure that as many, if not all, of the senatorial candidates will make it to the Magic 12.
Right, but a big supporter, one big supporter of the administration, which the administration lost recently, is Vice President Sara Duterte. Tell us, She earlier said that she has yet to endorse a senatorial candidate for the 2025 midterm elections. But do you still believe that the vice president, as of the moment, is still a viable endorser at this point, given all the issues that have been hurled against her recently?
Let's remember Sara Duterte has a good record of being able to convert candidates into senators, as we have seen in both 2019 and 2022. So I do think that based on the track record of her political support, she's still able to mobilize a sizable number of voters, particularly in Mindanao, where at present her popularity ratings is almost perfect. Like we haven't seen any politician that is able to unify political support in Mindanao, unlike the Dutertes. And given the political battles that she's currently facing, at the moment she's able to evade this and rally her base. And we've seen in social media, despite the criticism on her recent actions, that there's also some level of defense and some level of unwavering support. And these voters are critical. This level of these supporters are critical. So I think we cannot totally count the Dutertes out. And despite the recent political developments, I think Sara Duterte is still hedging in the sense that she's still not endorsing at the moment because she's still observing, and because the election is still a few months away, and we have yet to see more developments. There might be other coalitions that are forming in reaction to the administration slate, and therefore we won't really see the viability of Sara Duterte's resilient political power perhaps until the campaign season starts next year.
The vice president earlier said that it is very possible for three of her relatives to run: former President Rodrigo Duterte, Representative Paulo Duterte, and Mayor Sebastian Duterte may all vie for a seat in the Senate. Now, regardless of the number of Dutertes who may run for senator, how will a Duterte Senate run actually affect the dynamics of the 2025 campaign?
Well, if indeed it will happen, because it seems like the last remarks of Vice President Sara Duterte is that she seemed unsure, unlike before. And this is quite the classic tactic employed by the Duterte family, is that they try to test an idea and then see whether there'll be some buy-in of these ideas. But if there will be a Duterte or several Dutertes running for the Senate, that will complicate the calculations of not only the administration slate, but also the opposition, as well as the other candidates for the Senate, because the way that the Senate is elected, it's block voting of the top 12. Therefore, it will really be a tight race wherein there might be very minimal differences between those who will be able to make it to the 12 and those who are not. And this makes the slate, the elections entirely more uncertain than before. And therefore, public opinion polling might not, in such cases, public opinion polling might not be pre-election. I mean, polling might not be the best indicator of the possible winners in May 2025.
All right, Aris, let's talk about the opposition side now. The Liberal Party endorsing the Senate bids of former Senators Kiko Pangilinan and Bam Aquino, as well as human rights lawyer Shel Jorno. All three of them have very good track records when it comes to passing pieces of legislation, as well as to defending several victims in court. And yet, they still failed to win, both in the 2019 and in the 2022 elections. What is wrong with their strategy?
Well, what happened to the Liberal Democratic opposition is not only a factor of their own doing. It has also something to do with the way that they've been deliberately pounced and you can say persecuted by the previous administration. This is a deliberate move to really not only delegitimize, but to really afford very minimal, if no space, for such an opposition. Because the previous government, unlike other governments before, have a different, if not total, lack of appreciation on the role of an opposition in democratic politics. So, but there's also been some miscalculations on the part of the Democratic Liberal opposition. But I do think they're trying. What's good is that they're learning from these missteps. And I think what we're seeing right now is a more calibrated, a more sober, and a more grounded appreciation of their sources of support. And I think for now, rather than having the optimal outcome of being able to get as many senators in the top 12, the opposition is spreading its bets and trying just to, you know, be reintroduced in legislative politics. So we're seeing, for example, the Makabayang Liberal as a party list, and even the idea that some of the possible senatorial candidates might run for as party list or even in the House instead. So the key is to occupy spaces of representation, regardless whether it's senatorial or even at the local level, just to capture some of these sources of power and build up and regain some of the support that they have lost in the previous two electoral cycles.
Okay, we understand that the Liberal Party is eyeing to coalesce with several other sectors, possibly Akbayan, as well as the Makabayan Bloc. How wise would that move be?
I think politics is addition, Katrina. So I think the more that the they claim, and it's quite correct that the genuine opposition and the liberal democratic, or at least the national democratic opposition and all these forces, the more that they're able to find common ground, and given their convergence on positions and how they perceive the Marcos junior administration as well as the Dutertes, it's quite clear that they have more to work towards in common than what separates them. But that is the challenge, because they also have a history of animosity and a history of differences with one another. But in countries that are able to challenge the predominant power of leaders that have been unhealthy for democracy, most of these fragmented forces are able to find common ground. And that remains the challenge of all of these sporadic opposition forces, because by themselves, they at the moment, they don't really, they're not as competitive. But if they're able to band together to agree on some pacts, some power sharing agreements, perhaps, then that could give them some a chance, or even an edge, or some level of competition that it will make it harder for administration, for reelectionists, for dynastic politicians to just get seats. They will have to earn this competitively against a united front of opposition forces.
Right. And finally, Aris, we all know that the 2025 midterm elections will not just be about the Senate races. We also have gubernatorial, congressional, mayoral, and other local posts up for grabs. What key races will you be keeping a close eye on?
Well, I mean, I think it's important that we look at places wherein there seem to be a predominance of dynasties, although a lot of places in the country are like this. But I think what I want to see is whether what you were saying earlier is that there's voter fatigue on dynasties is true. So we're going to see whether there are enough dynastic challengers that will try and compete with these entrenched dynasties. So I think those are key races, because if, for example, a challenger of dynasties is able to topple down a strong and powerful dynasty, then that could help Filipino voters imagine Philippine politics, that our politics can transcend dynasties, and that there is a way, so long as certain other people are able to put themselves out there and run for office. I don't have any place in mind right now, but I do think that there are some challengers, there are some outsiders, new faces, new voices that might be able to challenge. And what I think for voters to do is to be at least able to hear them, to listen to them, because if not, then we will just keep the vicious cycle of electing the same names, the same people. And then we wonder why this country hasn't moved and hasn't made any progress.
Well, we're eager to see if there will be more dynasty slayers in the upcoming midterm elections. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, and we look forward to hearing more from you as the campaign season progresses on. Thanks for joining us, political science professor Aris Arugay.
Thank you so much, Katrina. Have a good day.